Good morning and welcome to the 10th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2021. The first item on our agenda today is a decision on taking business in private. Can I ask whether members are content to take agenda item 4 in private? Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Thank you. Moving on to our main item of business this week, the committee will take evidence on the impact of COVID-19 on children and young people from socio-economically deprived backgrounds. And we will be taking evidence from John Dickey, Director of Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, Dr. Colin Morrison, Co-Director of the Children's Parliament, and Satwat Raymond, who is the CEO of One Parent Families Scotland. And Satwat is virtual this morning. And John and Colin are present with us physically in the committee room. It's nice to see you here as well. So thank you all for your time today. We will immediately get our questioning underway. We hope to have you for at least an hour and a half or so, maybe a bit longer. We'll see how it goes. And I'm going to turn first to my colleague, Stephanie, who's going to lead the questioning. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. And good morning, panel. Thanks for coming along today. Can I ask, first of all, whether you believe the aim to close the poverty-related attainment gap is an achievable goal, or should we really be talking about narrowing the attainment gap? Probably if I ask that to John.
Yeah. Well, I think we need to make it an achievable goal. I think, obviously, progress towards that needs to be about narrowing that gap. But I think when we set targets and we say it's not right for children to attainment and achievement at school to be undermined by their home circumstances, by poverty, we need to put everything in place to achieve that target. I wouldn't want to do anything to undermine or to suggest that that's not achievable. It is achievable. What it will take is action on two fronts. On the one hand, action to tackle the underlying drivers of poverty, to make sure that all our families actually have adequate incomes to give their children a decent start in life and enable their children to participate fully at school and in every other aspect of life. And that means the kind of action that we're seeing beginning to take place, investing in the Scottish Child Payment, removing barriers to work for parents, increasing levels of funded childcare, all the things that we know are needed to tackle and meet the child poverty targets. But at the same time, we need to see action within the education system to remove the barriers that exist for those children from families with lower incomes.
Okay, I don't know if anybody wants to add anything to that.
I think, Michael, you wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, so yesterday we had some pretty significant announcements regarding changes to the Scottish Attainment Challenge, which is one of the key mechanisms that the government is seeking to use to address the poverty-related attainment gap. Those shifts, and I think you may have followed them, I suppose. Did you? Yeah. I mean, and John, yeah. And obviously, you know, the Parliament didn't perhaps receive as much detail as some of us might have wished in terms of the kind of the direct funding allocation issues. But what's clear is that the money that's been attributed to 9 local authorities, the most deprived communities in Scotland, has now been spread more widely across all local authorities. John, if I can this question to you, I know that you know the City of Dundee well. You've given evidence to the Dundee Poverty Commission. I mean, that's resulting in a significant cut to the amount of resource. Do you have any initial thoughts in terms of what the impact of that might be in terms of our ability to deal with that poverty-related attainment gap?
Well, I suppose the first thing to say is I think it's right that we do ensure that funding reaches all parts of Scotland, because we know that children live in poverty in every part of Scotland, and that actually most children living in poverty don't live in the most deprived areas. So it's absolutely right to find ways of ensuring resources meet need and are allocated to in a way that ensures that wherever you're growing up in Scotland, if you're growing up in a low-income family, your local school, your local authority has the resources to ensure that there are no barriers, there's no charges, there's nothing that will stop your full participation at school. At the same time, we would certainly be concerned if any area was to actually invest less or to have less resources to tackle the to tackle that gap. So I certainly urge local authorities and government to work together to ensure that that's not the case. We don't want to see any area reducing the amount of resource, the amount of focus that's going into tackling that attainment gap.
Yeah, I mean Dundee has about, I think, over 100 members of staff that's tied to the funding through the Scottish Attainment Challenge at the moment, which, you know, is going to be reduced, we believe, by potentially up to, could be up to 80% in terms of that money. So I think your fears around that may well be realised. Any comments on those areas and the changes from Colin or from Satwat?
Not from me. I don't know the detail, and I'm sure the local authorities will be working out their responses to that.
Is that what? No? Okay.
I was just waiting to be unmuted. Apologies for that. I think I would just reinforce what John has said. Obviously, we want to ensure that there's funding available across the country to support those who are impacted by the poverty-related attainment gap. And that the bigger issue is to ensure that where there is funding required, what we have is adequate, and where we need additional funding, it is that collaboration to work together to look to see what the sum of resources are available and how we can utilise what is available to ensure that those who are at the greatest risk of poorer outcomes due to poverty are enabled to be able to achieve on a par with their peers. And so I would, again, also urge joint working and collaboration to look to see how we can make the most of what resources are available across all sectors, including some of the valuable work done by the third sector, to be able to support families, as John was saying, with the underlying causes and with the structural inequalities that cause low income at a family level, and then what additional measures can be put in place to support young people in schools and around schools and learning.
Okay, thank you. I mean, I think the point's made in terms of making sure that everybody who is in poverty across Scotland can access support is absolutely right and correct. I have no problem with that at all. In fact, it's, you know, it's an imperative that we have to rise to. I wonder if you could comment in terms of the particular character of poverty in the most deprived areas, though, where young people won't have access to the same kinds of opportunities, facilities. Actually, the character, for instance, you know, taken to Glasgow, you know, where is such a concentration of the most impoverished young people in Scotland are in the Glasgow city area. And the fact that there are fewer resources, fewer opportunities around that, what is the character, I suppose, of that kind of poverty that creates particular barriers to learning? John?
Sorry, yeah. So I suppose that there are, I mean, as I sort of said, it is this, we need to look at things both at place-based and individual. So we need to, it is right to ensure that children living in families growing up in poverty, wherever they are supported and the systems are in place and the funding's in place to do that. There are additional barriers where there are particular concentrations of disadvantage, thinking in terms of, you know, what we've picked up, transport barriers, you know, children not being able to access the kind of out-of-school opportunities or even the school opportunities because of transport barriers, you know, less access to childcare for parents and the quality of that childcare not necessarily at the same level as it is in better-off areas. There are additional barriers that exist at a place level, and those need to be tackled as well. And I suppose that's where we would kind of see again the importance of linking up education policy and education funding with wider action to tackle poverty, disadvantage in the different ways that it plays out for different groups in Scotland. So it's about both.
Okay, that's really useful, John. Colin, comments on those specific areas of high multiple deprivation and those particular. Some of them, most of them, are urban areas.
I mean, for me, maybe rewinding a wee bit, I think that it's families that need support. It's families that need income. It's families that need to be able to manage their lives, raise their children, provide the things that children need, and that is a priority. And the education system itself won't sort some of the kind of fundamental experiences or consequences of poverty. It's families that need an effective income and need support, and communities that need decent resources and provision locally for them. But in terms of what the system can do, it maybe just needs to be a bit smarter about where those interventions need to be. So, for example, we know that an investment in speech and language therapy in the early years reaps great benefits for children who are living in families where they're maybe not immersed in reading and literacy and the kind of verbal communication and support for those kind of things. So it's about looking, I just feel these conversations can be so general that we don't actually look at what's impactful either in terms of people's lives, and that's about dignity and control of their own lives and their own income. And it's also about targeting the interventions that we know, it's particularly in the early years and in primary school, that have an impact. So we only need to look at our prison population to understand the impact of not doing anything around emotional well-being, around what child should leave school functionally illiterate in a modern society. That should not be happening. Mm-hmm. But if you look at our prison population, we can see the consequences of that. So maybe a bit of a scattergun response, I don't know, but it seems to me that the impact of poverty can only be tackled if we look at what those lived experiences are and target resources at them.
Okay, thank you.
We'll go back to Stephanie now to pick up on her line of questions.
Thank you, Convener. And sorry, I didn't make myself clear earlier on. I was kind of inviting another panel members to make comment there. I'm just wondering, now, John and Colin, in fact, everyone, I think, has actually touched on a few of the things as well, the kind of broader societal measures around that are impacting education, around poverty, early years, etc. I'm wondering, are there any other particular local or national policies that you see kind of dovetailing to support closing the attainment gap? I'm quite happy for anyone to answer that, John.
I mean, I suppose I'd come back. This is fundamentally about tackling poverty, and poverty is about families not having enough money to give their children a decent start in life, give their children the same opportunities as their better-off peers. So we do need to see national policies that tackle at root cause child poverty and ensure that families have enough money. So there are policies that dovetail with this, and I mentioned earlier the new Scottish Child Payment, making use of Scotland's social security powers to invest directly in low-income families, is a policy that dovetails with this. It's a policy as yet that needs to be built on. There's no credible route that we can see, or the independent analysis can see, that would allow us to meet our child poverty targets, and at the same time close the attainment gap, which requires tackling poverty at root source, without, at the very least, doubling the Scottish Child Payment in the coming year, with further action around that to ensure targets are met. But that's one policy lever. That's probably the most immediate thing that this Parliament and this Government can do to make progress on child poverty, which obviously integrates with the education closing the attainment gap agenda. But there's the wider ones in terms of, you know, building on the commitments around investing in funded childcare, removing barriers to employment for parents and particularly women, looking at the rewards for work in our labour market. We need to see fundamental changes to ensure that women particularly and parents, but mums particularly, have opportunities to progress in the labour market, have the childcare available to enable them to increase their hours and improve their earnings, have the progression opportunities that allow them to do that. These are the policies that will help to end child poverty, and by ending that child poverty, we can go a long way to plugging the attainment gaps that exist within our education system.
Thank you, John. I don't know if any of the other panel members want to come in, and then I've just got a very short question for John directly.
Yes, go ahead.
Can I come in, is that okay?
Yes, of course, yes.
Right, okay, thank you. I'm going to talk about single parents, or one of the priority groups within the Child Poverty Act, where there's a much greater risk of families being in poverty to begin with. And what we saw during the pandemic was an intensification of the conditions that created poverty for many of these families. And I think John's right to say that we need to begin to look at other policies like childcare, like how we can create something of a childcare offer from the family basis, which supports that really, really important early learning experience for children in high quality settings, but enables the parents to look at how they can enter into training, employment, progress in employment, because I think one of the big issues we see with single parents is that whilst they may enter work, they tend to stay then in those entry-level jobs, part-time hours, very few opportunities to look to see how they can progress. So I think in terms of the other policy agendas, we need to look at Fair Work and see what can be done around the Fair Work in the short term for the parents. In the longer term, how we create those high-quality opportunities for training, particularly for young people living in low-income families. I think we need to look at how we can dovetail more closely with further and higher education, particularly further education, if that's an option that young people want to take. And I think one of the things that we found had a particular impact on families during this period, over and above the financial stresses which increased, was the digital divide. And we need to look to see how anything that's being done to connect across Scotland, etc., recognises the need for connectivity as well as devices, as well as support for families to be able to access the things that we can. I mean, one of the things that we heard over and over again from families was the stresses of trying to manage during the pandemic with homeschooling, possibly with having to work from home for some of the families, having more than one child across different age groups within school and trying to manage all that on one small device. So we need to be looking at some of those measures that can level up for families to make sure that the playing field is more equal were we to have any further restrictions, but also more generally enable to be able to access some of the learning opportunities that are available for young people. So I would definitely say something around childcare. We need to look at Fair Work, employability, employment support, and then the digital divide as well. The one other area that I think it's really important to think about, again, just based on what families had spoken to us about, is how we can ensure there's adequate and targeted mental health and wellbeing support for the children and young people, but also for the parents. What we heard was the sort of generalised anxiety that many of us felt around the pandemic, how that was impacting on families and therefore their capacity to engage in other things when they became available, and also the particular stresses of being the sole carer at home during lockdown, trying to manage things, the impact that had on the parents and consequently on their children as well. So I would definitely think we need to look at how some of those additional services and supports can be built around what we have in place for children's learning to make sure that they can make the most of those opportunities.
That's great. Thanks very much. Yeah, touching a lot of really important points there, and I think some of those will be picked up later in the committee by my colleagues there too. But it's good to know that really the Scottish Government's focus on wellbeing going forward as well, childcare, etc., is we're on the right track with that there. A very direct question for you there, John, too. Now, I know that COVID has kind of been a bit of a leveller in some ways as well. There are families who would never expected to have been in poverty who suddenly, you know, tragedy has struck and the rug's been ripped from under their feet there. So there is that feeling generally, I think, that people appreciate the fact that it could happen to any of us at any time. But just going back a wee bit there as well, I'm actually a councillor at South Lancashire Council as well. And part of our parent councils were doing the Child Poverty Action Group Poverty Proof in Schools, and it seemed to make quite an impact locally. I was just wondering if you could tell us a little bit about the outcomes that you've had from that, how effective it was. Thanks.
Yeah, so this is the Cost of School Day project that CPAG runs and started off in Glasgow, intensively supporting the local authority and schools in Glasgow to support children, young people and parents and school communities, teachers, to identify what are the cost barriers, the resource barriers that are preventing children from fully participating at school. Gone on to develop that work in Dundee, working in schools in Moray now, and taking that work to develop online resources, toolkits, providing support and training to school leaders, to trainee teachers, to raise awareness of the impact that poverty has, and to identify the practical things that can happen at a school community level, involving, as I say, young people, teachers, parents, at every level. We know from our direct feedback ourselves that has an impact, but we also know from evaluation commissioned by Public Health Scotland that it has an impact, and that when barriers are removed, schools report and evidence increased levels of participation, increased levels of engagement at school. So these things do make a difference. I think what the pandemic did was throw into sharp relief many of the things that we'd been identifying and parents and young people had been identifying as barriers, such as not having digital devices, not having connectivity at home. These were preventing children from doing homework, from being able to fully engage with their schoolwork pre-pandemic. Sometimes they were sort of seen as a bit of a luxury, that these things weren't really what children, young people didn't actually need their own device, which actually now it's become absolutely clearly that you do need access to digital connectivity to devices to be able to do your work is absolutely critical. So in that sense, I think it's, if there's a silver lining, that's become absolutely clear. And I think there is a greater awareness of the extent to which lack of resources at home can prevent full participation at school. Another thing that came out through the work that's maybe worth flagging was how important communication between school and parents and carers and homeward and with pupils themselves. And we did two surveys of children, young people and parents during the two periods of lockdown during the pandemic. What came back from that, both from parents and from young people, was where schools communicated and asked questions, do you have the resources you need, how are you getting on, how appreciated that was. But in other, it was inconsistent. So in other areas, you know, parents telling us that nobody had ever asked if they'd, you know, did they have the device, did they have the technology, did they have the support to be able to for their children to continue to engage at school. So the importance of communications and how that communication is done as well, so that, I suppose, giving confidence to schools, staff, school communities, to be able to, and parents and parent councils, to talk about issues of money and costs and resources in a way that's not stigmatising, that's not singling out individual families in the school, but it's just taking this as a standard part of the school day, that there's a recognition that families are under pressure, they don't all have the resources that that maybe previously it was assumed that they did have, and that we talked that they're able to talk to parents. So we've produced a toolkit on talking about costs and money at school to support, I suppose, and just spread the good practice that exists in so many schools and so many individual classrooms, but make sure that that's promoted and spread across Scotland.
Thanks, John. Really important, I think, you know, that parents, all parents, understand the impact of poverty and take that into account as well when we're making decisions. Thank you.
Can I just add something very quickly to that? I've seen this work with children directly. You know, it's not just with kind of adults and professionals. So when we see children using these tools and talking about poverty, what it does is it destigmatizes that experience. It frames it as a matter of social justice and rights, so that children who collectively, children understand what that means for everybody, but it also means if you're a child who's having these experiences, you're no longer left feeling that it's your responsibility, that your family are failing you, that you should be embarrassed by that. But it creates a space for conversation. I think it's really powerful work, and it moves that idea of charity to one of dignity and rights. And so I think it's really important work. We really admire it.
Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie. John, can I ask you a question, listening to what you're talking about in terms of all these different dimensions that have surfaced during the pandemic? Has anything about the nature of child poverty fundamentally changed because of the pandemic? I mean, are we measuring child poverty in the right ways?
I don't think, I mean, fundamentally, this poverty, you know, these levels of poverty existed pre-pandemic. The pandemic has thrown them into sharp relief and also exacerbated, and in many cases deepened, the poverty that families are faced. And then on top of that, all the other pressures that families generally have faced during the pandemic, but which are particularly acute if you don't have enough money. The way that we measure poverty, understand it primarily as about lack of income, but have a range of measures here in Scotland and a range of measures which we measure progress against around income, around material deprivation, around the persistence of that poverty. Those are, I think, still the right measures for measuring progress. We need to, you know, this is fundamentally about families not having the money and then the choices and the limitations that that creates. I suppose one of the, again, I suppose one of the, it's a positive that's emerged from the pandemic, or some of the learning that's happened during the pandemic, has been that recognition that this is the best way to support families on low incomes is to ensure they have more money. So when we saw, for example, the response to the replacement of free school meals during lockdown, there was a range of responses, you know, vouchers, food in kind partials, as well as cash responses. And what was very clear from the feedback from the surveys we did, and more generally, was that what worked was cash. That's what gave parents the dignity to be able to go and make the choices and the food choices that they knew that the family needed, gave them that dignity. So there may have been sort of good intentions behind some of the other approaches, but actually for families and for parents, it's recognising for the, you know, we're talking about 1 in 4 children living in poverty in Scotland, 1 in 4 families. You know, what they need is additional money, not and charity handouts and need to be absolute backup to that. But for the vast majority of low-income families, they need opportunities to improve their earnings and work, and they need a decent social security safety net that provides support when they're having to juggle care and responsibilities, when they face disability, ill health, or crises like the pandemic.
Describing as the root causes of poverty. Exactly. Yes, Colin.
Can I just add something to that? What we also know from last year, from the work that Children's Parliament did, was that 1 in 4 children, roughly in terms of 2 measures, 1 in 4 children told us from our large-scale surveys that their families were struggling financially. So they are, can you imagine, you're 8, you're 10, you're 11 years old, and you know that. And also, similarly to another statement about worries, 1 in 4 children told us that they were worried about their family's income and what they had. And that increased through the pandemic. Mm-hmm. So we know from good data that 1 in 4 children are living in poverty, mm-hmm. but we also know from our work that 1 in 4 children know that they're living in poverty and they worry about it.
Mm-hmm. Anxiety.
And that mm-hmm. then they take that into their learning, they take that into their other social experiences. And mm-hmm. that for me is incredibly worrying.
Willie Rennie.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm interested just to go back a little bit to the attainment challenge, because it addresses a wider question, the direction of travel from the government. We all know that poverty impacts on education and the poverty-related attainment gap is quite wide. The issue, I suppose, is who should lead on tackling the poverty? And the indication yesterday was that the education system would have a bigger role. Now, it already has a role in trying to address the relationship between poverty and education. But the direction of travel was the education system would have more of a role in that. Now, I don't have a fixed position on this. I'm just interested in the direction of travel as to whether it's right that the education system that's got already many challenges should have additional responsibilities on the issues of poverty. So I'm just interested in whether there should be a greater focus for the education system on education rather than the wider issues, or whether it should be expanding its role to cover the poverty issues too.
Okay. For me, the question's a problem. I think for me, if you're suggesting that there's something very pure about what education does, that it's not impacted by the social circumstances that children live in, that it doesn't have to consider what children bring into the classroom, if the suggestion is that education has some kind of very narrow understanding of what learning and teaching is, then that's a problem for me. This Parliament, every single person here, has voted to incorporate the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child. This is all our responsibilities now. So we're all duty bearers, your duty bearers, whatever emerges from various educational reform work, the new systems, the new structures that are set up, are public authorities that are duty bearers. And we have a duty to all children and young people to live a life with dignity. Poverty is the greatest infringement of human rights. And we see that reflected in attainment within certain communities or for children from certain backgrounds. But we need to not consider that we're asking education to do, we're not layering something else on top. It's not another initiative. If you start with the human dignity of the individual infringed by poverty, then that becomes as much my responsibility as a primary six teacher as it does yours as an MSP. So we can't separate these things.
So what would you want teachers, schools, the education system to do? What extra thing could it do, extra responsibility could it take on to try and assist with the things that you've talked about?
What I'm saying is it's not extra.
Okay, so it's not extra, but what?
First of all, you enter into that educational experience with rights-based relationships. So children know that they're loved, they're cared for, that you have an understanding for them. That's the starting point as an educator. Then as an educator, you need to be able to address the needs of the children as learners. So I've already mentioned things like speech and language therapy. We sometimes forget the first 1,000 days of a child's life because we think of an education system as being 3 to 18, as if nothing happens before a third birthday, when we know that during pregnancy and in those first hundreds of days, outcomes can feel as though they're already fixed. And that's based in poverty, usually. So what I'm saying is that if we start with the child and their carers, their parents, we understand their needs and we address those needs. That can be income, it can be support. We've not even mentioned disability. You know, for me, if we're really going to try and tackle some of the fundamental core issues alongside poverty, we need to look at disability, because people living with disabilities and children with disabilities are disproportionately more likely to be living in poverty as well. So it's almost impossible to pull these things apart. That what we need to do as an educator, as I was at one point, my interest was in the whole child, and it was an interest in their family and an interest in their community. And I couldn't pull those things apart, nor would I want to. I might be wanting to improve certain skills in terms of literacy. That would have been my specialism. But what I'm saying is that had to be located in this broader understanding of their lives. And as an educator, my job would have been to fight poverty. It's that basic for me.
So I don't know if you've got any disagreement from me on that. But the direction of travel indicated yesterday was that education should have a greater responsibility. And I'm just intrigued as to what that should be that's not been covered by other parts of the public service. I don't know, John, do you want to come in?
Yes, I mean, I'd echo a lot of what Colin has said in terms of the role of education. It's about within the education system, what needs to be done to ensure that every child has access to the opportunities and all that Scotland's education system has to offer. And there is a real job to be done there. And it's already happening in lots of schools, you know, and it's sort of integral to the work of schools anyway. Understanding your school community, understanding the young people in your classroom, understanding the barriers and challenges they face, identifying where cost issues are actually preventing them from participation, whether that's school trips, costs of dress down days, school events that make them feel uncomfortable because there's money involved. You know, that's just about good practice and kind of developing an understanding of your teachers. So that to me is the role of education. I think there is ways in which we can add to that, and also already been added to that, in terms of there's a key place where families and children engage with public services, so a key place where that additional support can be provided. For example, examples of in Edinburgh, Glasgow and elsewhere of financial inclusion being built into schools so that there's access to advice and information on the financial supports that are available to families, engaging with parents about wider issues around employment and employability. And there's opportunities to build these things in and around schools, working with other bits of public services and the third sector to do that. None of that takes away from the fundamental importance of policies to address child poverty and improve family incomes through investment in social security, through improving rewards from work in the workplace, removing barriers to work for parents and so on. So these two things, to me, go side by side. I wouldn't see this as being, and I suppose I haven't looked at the data, but I haven't seen any kind of suggestion that somehow those things are less important or being offloaded onto education. So I suppose I would be concerned if there's a sense that education, and we have had periods in the past and elsewhere where education in itself has been seen as the solution to poverty, as a way of kind of avoiding the reality of what's actually driving levels of child poverty. I don't see that in Scotland. I think we've got a real consensus in this Parliament. You know, everybody, all the parties supported the Child Poverty Act, supported the terms of that act, the measures that are in place to tackle child poverty, supported the requirement on government to produce a child poverty delivery plan that focuses on the drivers of child poverty, which are lack of income from work, social security, high costs that families face. So I don't see anything that is diverting away from that, but I think there's a role for education in all this as well.
Before I bring Satwat in, I just want to try and perhaps move it on to the issue about looking back to the pandemic. There was some evidence provided, including some case studies, about families that found it difficult to get childcare, even though their employers were requiring them to go back to work. Was that the responsibility of the employers, or was it lack of synchronicity with the easing of the lockdown? So, the government was given an indication that companies could take their workers back. Meanwhile, the childcare wasn't up to full speed yet. Or was it bad practice by employers? Satwat, I don't know if you want to answer my first question as well as addressing that one too.
Yep, sure thing. I'll try and address both. If I can just start with the first one, then I'll come on to the childcare one, if that's okay. There's a quote in our evidence, which I think is really critical to who should, the whole question about should there be a lead or how does the responsibility for tackling child poverty lie? And that is, children don't just walk in, they bring their families and their lives with them. And I think that's critical when we're looking at addressing child poverty. You know, a child in a school doesn't just suddenly leave everything at the school gate. It's all there. But I would say that I think, as both the previous speakers have said, that it should be joint responsibility. That's not to say there aren't particular actions or areas where certain services could be seen to take a lead, but it has to be in collaboration and partnership with all the other services I spoke about earlier, because what we need are holistic family-based solutions. And I think most critical to this would be, I think as Colin said, the voices of children, young people and parents in terms of what they need and what's going to make the difference to them on the various fronts that poverty manifests in their lives and how it manifests in their lives. So what we have is something that is going to work for the family. And I think that's critical in all this. And the avenues to enter into that support It is really about thinking about where are those families and those children and young people going to feel comfortable being able to express what's happening, being able to look at what they need, and using that as the starting point. And all our statutory services and additional services are critical to us being able to end child poverty and also end the poverty-related attainment gap. And so it is about the coming together and the collaboration that I think is going to make a difference. And as Colin said, the role of education isn't just about what happens in those structured lessons, etc. It's the broader stuff that goes around that, because like I said, children bring their lives with them when they come into school. On the issue of childcare and childcare availability, I do think that in some cases, some employers were putting unreasonable pressures on parents to be able to come back to the pre-pandemic ways of working. And that was something that we heard from the single parents that we work with, that it was happening almost in parallel and at a different pace to the way services, quite rightly, were being a bit more cautious about how they opened up and how we could keep everyone safe within schools, within nurseries, etc., at a time when things were changing so quickly. So I do think there was a bit of responsibility there. I also think that there's some learning we can take from this, should we ever find ourselves in this position again, in terms of how we organise the support and how we differentiate the support, recognising the different needs of different types of families. I mean, we found with single parent families, there were some at the start of the pandemic and the first hard lockdown that we had, who were key workers, who were trying to get access to key worker childcare, for example, or for their children to be able to go to some of the hubs that were available. But because we were doing everything so quickly, there wasn't the usual levels of consideration and consultation that service providers might have engaged in to make sure that they were being inclusive and getting it right. So we had forms coming out for key workers to be able to request childcare, which asked if you were a key worker, and this parent said she ticked yes. It then asked if your partner was a key worker. It didn't give you the option to be able to say you were a single parent. And the only way you could move on and submit the form was to tick either yes or no. She ticked no, which made her ineligible, therefore, for the support for her children. In the first instance, that was then pointed out to the authority where that happened, and they quickly addressed it. So I do think there's some of this. We were all doing this more quickly and in a way we'd never worked before. And I think it's really important for us to almost take stock now, like we're doing here, look at the learning from what's happened, and look to see what does that mean for how we develop and build our services anyway, and what measures should we be looking at having in place should we find ourselves in this situation again. And this is where it goes back to fair work. It goes back to looking at more family-friendly, flexible working generally, which can then be put into place and used when we find ourselves, should we do so again, having to go into further restrictions.
Got one more question.
One more quick question. And then we'll go to
Oliver. It's just about the digital divide. There were reports back in July last year that even though laptops and digital devices had been purchased, they actually hadn't been distributed to the pupils in need until the August. I mean, what was your experience of that? Do you think that the system worked quickly enough? Have you got any evidence to add to that report?
I know that a number of children we work with, and we often work with children who are not finding school engagement or learning easy in the first place, they fell off the radar that first 3-4 months. They were just gone to the education system. What I also know is that many head teachers we knew who love and care for their children were literally scrambling about and delivering devices every day, knocking on doors, making sure people had food, never mind digital devices. And so, you know, there were some amazing practice that has really enriched the ongoing relationships that a school has with some of these families who were struggling most. But the first few months were chaotic. It's still the case that some families don't have the digital devices that they need. And once that disengagement happened for some children and families, it was very, very difficult to re-engage. So it will have long-term consequences for some of these children in terms of attendance, the ability to kind of work in that blended way, the way that other children have become really much more used to their digital engagement with learning and are taking that home and using that to build on learning currently. So there is, if there's a gap in attainment, there's certainly a gap still in how children are using that digital space to learn. For some children, it's just kind of taken off and they're blossoming with it. For other children, there's a legacy of disengagement that's going to be difficult to address.
John? I mean, very much echo that. I mean, I suppose the first thing to say, it made a difference. You know, the feedback from our surveys was that where those children, those families got devices, that transformed things and made a big difference in terms of their ability to engage, but it was inconsistent. You know, I think it was around a third of the young people that responded who are on low income, from low income families, were saying they still didn't have access to a device. So there's clearly still a way to go. And I suppose that's why the commitment to ensure that every school child has access to a digital device and the connectivity to use that is so important. But we need to get to a stage where that's just, it doesn't rely on which organisation you happen to be engaging with, doesn't rely on a particular head teacher or teacher to think, oh, that they might need that. It's just an accepted part of, you know, to engage in school in Scotland, you need a device, and that's just, we ensure that every child has one.
That's convenient.
Thank you, Willie. Yes, a quick supplementary from Oliver, followed by a quick supplementary from Bob, and then we're going to come back to Oliver for his new line of questioning.
Okay. Thank you, convener. It's going back to Willie Rennie's first line of question. I listened to Jim Wallace from Aberlour on the radio the other morning, you know, and he was saying, you know, I don't want to kind of misquote him, but he sort of was saying effectively there should be more of a role for the third sector. And I guess my concern is, you know, I'm enthusiastic to have more teachers and more support staff in schools, but I guess the question is money that's designed for tackling poverty really there, you know, to just bring in more teachers? And, you know, with the accountability structures that are there, you know, effectively local authorities, you know, have a quite a big say in how this money is spent and are in some cases directing head teachers. Is it, you know, is that the right way to are we accessing the right expertise there? You know, is there really, you know, partnership working, or you know, could this money be distributed differently? I guess would be my question.
Just say it's a bit cumbersome to negotiate with 32 local authorities if you're a national organisation, and then sometimes to be expected to negotiate with school clusters, and then sometimes expected to negotiate with individual schools about something that you can provide is very difficult. So where there are kind of good existing relationships, these things have kind of grown, but it's not easy for many third sector agencies. They don't often have the capacity or the resource to do all the negotiation and kind of tendering and all the rest of it that is hugely time consuming. So that's a very kind of broad statement. I'm not saying that's true everywhere, but it's certainly difficult for third sector organisations, even the big ones, to negotiate and to access some funding streams.
It's just really whether we're getting the priority right, whether, you know, a lot of the money that's going in for equity, you know, is ending up plugging, you know, staffing shortages, you know, looking at other things that are very education focused, which, you know, I recognise that there's a gap there, but it's just whether, you know, this money, you know, whether the third sector and other people have better expertise, you know, in addressing poverty, whether they're getting a full, you know, a full chance to use the money as best we can.
And the reason that there's some kerfuffle at this end of the table is because we've lost our colleagues who are virtual, and therefore, once you've finished this question, I'm afraid I'm going to have to suspend the committee until we can recover the technology. So sorry for the distraction, John.
Shall I come back in?
You can come back in and we'll finish this exchange and then we'll suspend.
So there's a role for third sector organisations and particularly for children and families who are, you know, haven't been engaged at school, who find school particularly difficult or haven't been at school, or to find ways of working with those families. And there's expertise that lies in the third sector to support those families, those children. And I think, as Jim was saying on the radio the other morning, for some of those families, actually, and some of those children, young people, actually found that the pressures of not going to school actually helped because they weren't previously able to engage or get the most out of school. So I think, and I suppose that's about local government, third sector, schools working to identify, you know, what additional support they need to ensure that, coming back to this thing, this is about ensuring that the resources are there so that wherever you go to school in Scotland, whatever your home background, you're able to access the opportunities, you have the same kinds of opportunities as children in better off areas or children on higher incomes in, or children and families on higher incomes in your area. And that's about ensuring that the resources are adequate to deliver that, to deliver a genuinely free education system and an education system that's genuinely open and able to engage and support children from whatever background they come from. And that does require, and there's examples of where that already involves third sector organisations in terms of providing that kind of support. So we need to learn from that.
At this point, I'm going to suspend our committee proceedings until we can get a technological solution. I do apologise.